Hello, I'm Jeremy Vine. Tonight on Panorama, hate on the doorstep. An Asian couple move onto an estate in Britain. This is how they're welcomed.
Oh, get back to your f***ing country.
Bye.
Britain red now. No.
Is Britain as tolerant as it likes to think it is?
Bang out.
What?
This isn't a unique picture at all. It's happening in similar comparable estates all over the country.
Out of state,
yeah. I just didn't think that you would be like that.
Tonight's film will be an eye-opener for anyone who thinks the sting has gone out of racism in Britain, and will strike a chord with anybody who's been bullied or suffered antisocial behaviour where they live, whatever the colour of their skin. As the far right edges into the political mainstream, with the BNP appearing on Question Time later this week, this is a good moment to experience what it's like to be singled out because of your race, to be on the receiving end of the P word and worse.
My name's Tamana Robin, and I'm living undercover to investigate the truth about racism in Britain.
While I'm making this programme, the BNP wins two seats in the European Parliament. And in Belfast, several Romanian families are forced from their homes by racist violence. Yet 6 months earlier, race relations in Britain are given a clean bill of health by the head of the government's equality watchdog.
We are a country where attitudes between individuals are really much better than anywhere else in Europe. You know, if you ask people in this country if they mind having somebody of a different ethnicity as a neighbour, it's really not an issue.
I was born in Manchester and grew up confident that neither my colour nor my religion would be held against me. But my experience is not shared by many other black and ethnic minority people. According to a charity called SARI, which handles around 350 cases of racism and racist violence a year.
And here's some examples of some of the cases we've been dealing with over the last few months. Here's one with eggs being thrown at them, water bombs being thrown at the property by local youths, racial verbal abuse being threatened with a knife, stones thrown at the victim when they got out of the bus, things being thrown at the shop window, so takeaway, threats to kill, an air gun being fired. Racial verbal abuse, arson, threats, criminal damage, car vandalism.
SARI is based in Bristol. From its waterfront bars and cafes, it's hard to imagine the city today as a hotbed of racial strife. But just a few miles outside the city centre, there's a housing estate, which according to SARI, reveals the ugly reality of racism in this country.
Verbal abuse, being spat at, nuisance knocking, rubbish nuisance, and death threats.
Where is that?
This is all in South Mead.
The South Mead estate was built in the 1930s and extended 20 years later. It's mainly white and working class. In recent years, more black and Asian people have moved in, and I'm going to be one of them. I want to investigate on the ground. The only way to do that is to live there undercover. I moved to the estate at the beginning of June with fellow reporter Amal Khan, who's going to pretend to be my husband. My family's originally from Bangladesh. His from Pakistan. We're both British Muslims. We've hidden secret cameras in the house we're renting and in our clothes. We arrive at our new home to find the British National Party has been canvassing for support in the European elections. During our stay, we see no other signs that they're active here. While I perfect my cover story as a housewife who speaks very little English, Armour makes out he's working as a part-time painter and decorator. We're going to appear as unsure of ourselves as any couple would who are new to the area.
It's 8 o'clock on Monday, the 8th of June. The headlines. The far-right BNP has gained its first two MEPs.
There's a huge amount of racism in this country. Overwhelmingly, it's directed against the indigenous British majority, which is one reason that we've done so well in these elections.
Later that day, I go shopping on the estates by myself for the first time.
I was carrying two very heavy bags and looking quite downcast. I walked past them and they didn't say anything, and then suddenly I heard a little scuffling sound and looked down, and basically a rock had just landed about a foot away from me, a rock about the size of my fist, which is actually quite big. I looked at them and turned back around again and heard the words "Paki." I think they did it to intimidate me. I think they did it to frighten me.
I recognise one of them and get a clear shot of him later. He's already named and shamed on the Avon and Somerset Police website. He's 23-year-old Mark Morris and has an antisocial behaviour order. I'm racially abused in virtually the same spot where a Sudanese security guard was punched in the face a year earlier. He's called Musa Mustafa and Armel goes to see him.
Yeah, one is a guy, one is a bus, and said, ask me that, how you are Somalian. One is I pass behind them half a meter, I speak to him, I said, wait a minute, Somalian, I'm not Somalian. It's a guy say, answer my question, nigga. I said, what, taking it over? He said, punch me in my face. I just go on the floor.
The punch breaks Musa's jaw in two places. In court, 23-year-old Daniel Reeves denies using racist language. He's convicted of GBH and cleared of racial aggravation. After a long decline in the estimated number of racist incidents, last year there was an increase. A significant number of victims are white, but you're much more likely to be a victim if you're not white. From the moment Armel and I arrive in Southmead, we notice a heavy police presence on the estate. But it doesn't deter Mark Morris and his mates from abusing me again. It's only the second day I've been out. And I've already been abused twice. Friday night on the Southmead estate. Gangs of teenagers are hanging out on street corners. Armel runs into one of them.
Hello.
Go on, pal.
Hi, mate. Got time?
Yeah. Is it you?
9 o'clock.
What?
Nine.
It's 9 o'clock.
In the background, I could hear people saying, take his phone, take his phone.
9 o'clock.
I started backing off. I didn't want them to take the phone.
Watch it.
Oh, thank you.
Sure?
Yeah, thank you.
Somebody threw chips at me and wanted to hit me on the side of the head.
What's the problem?
Yeah. You hit me! You hit me now! You hit me now!
I heard somebody say, please don't blow us up.
During our stay, Armel and I learn of the trial of a Bristol Muslim on terror charges.
And behind me, I could just hear one loud shout.
Not everyone treats us badly.
Yes. I was looking for Ringwood.
Ringwood Crescent?
Yeah.
Oh, it's right down there.
Go right down, go up, second turn on the left, go along, and your Ringwood comes off.
You're fine.
Right.
Excuse me, we're on Doncaster Road.
If you go straight to the end of the road, that road there is Doncaster.
Oh, thank you.
Back home in Manchester, I take this kind of help for granted. In Southmead, I feel like hugging anyone who's friendly. Southmead is a priority for Sari, but victims of racism and racist violence contact the charity from other areas of Bristol too. I travel to one of them, a housing estate called St. Anne's. It's 5 miles from Southmead. 3 months earlier, Sri Lankan shop workers were targeted by racist thugs who shouted "Paki slaves" before this happened. Stephen Minnell, Ashley Stockham, and a third man are all convicted of the attack. Within minutes of arriving in St. Anne's, I wish I hadn't.
I just didn't think my humans could be like that. I wasn't doing anything, I was just walking down the street. And you know, they wanted to hurt me.
I saw in front of me, to my right, a whole gang of young people. I felt it before I heard it, but I basically felt on my foot a kind of sharp pain, and then I heard glass crash to the floor in front of me.
Don't look at me, mate, you're ugly.
Then I turned around and again I heard glass being thrown just by my foot again, and again hit really hard.
It's the girl in the white t-shirt who tells me to get out of the estate. She's 17-year-old Kelly Bray Warner. A few minutes later, I see her again, outside the shop where the racist attack happened. She's captured on CCTV with a gang of youths. I'm on the other side of the road, just out of shot.
Then I turn around, turn my back on them, and just to the left of me, a stone about that big came whizzing past my head.
It's Kelly Bray Warner who hurls the first stone. Another teenager joins in. The pair throw 5 stones at me. Luckily, I'm not hit. If I lived in Bristol for real, being pelted with glass and stones would be more than enough to send me to Sari seeking help. But the charity says the scope of its work is under threat after failing to win essential funding from the Equality and Human Rights Commission, or EHRC, headed by Trevor Phillips.
Dealing with hate crime, racially motivated hate crime, and supporting many, many local people in our region to overcome inequalities because they're from a black or minority ethnic community, I cannot believe that isn't one of their priorities.
The EHRC says Sari failed to supply enough detail about their plans and says it receives far more requests for funding than it can meet. Professor Kay Hampton recently resigned her post as an EHRC commissioner. She claims that both the watchdog and its leader, Trevor Phillips, who said having a neighbour of a different race isn't an issue anymore, are out of touch.
I think if Trevor, gets down to the grassroots to meet the real people who are suffering from racism, he probably will change his attitude. A day in the life of somebody ordinary, I think. I mean, it's all very well talking about it's not a problem anymore. In his world, it's probably not a problem. He's made it. Maybe sometimes one needs to talk to people who can't understand why they need to be British.